season is finally upon us. A time when heroes are born.
Wayne Gretzky in on goal. Just scores in overtime.
And legends make their mark on history.
Behind the net, the Sanderson door! On the door!
It's a little different than it was last year.
A miserable year for hockey fans in Canada.
This season, hope is at an all-time high right here in Canada.
McDavid backhand, upstairs, scores!
Scores! What a play by Matthews!
Oh, my stars, what a stop by Carey Price!
Gaudreau, wraparound, scores!
What a goal!
Canadian teams continue on the path to reclaim the country's greatest prize.
Well, there's not a young hockey player in Canada that wouldn't love to have his name on that cup.
100 years of amazing hockey moments have graced our lives. Who will have their moment this year? 16 teams left. 16 wins to grab the cup. Get ready.
Here we go, folks.
Here we go.
It's time for the Hockey Central Stanley Cup Playoff Preview Show. It starts right now. Welcome into the Hockey Central Stanley Cup Playoff Preview, presented by the Fate of the Furious. 1,230 games are in the books. We're into the round of 16. The best 16 teams still remain. They're chasing history. They're chasing the most elusive trophy in all of sports, the Stanley Cup. Elliot Friedman, Doug McLean, I'm David Amber. This is going to be fun.
Best time of year, the fate of the Furious. A lot of angry players over the next 2 months. Yeah.
And I love the fact that I think the Canadian teams really have a chance to do some serious damage in the playoffs. They're that much improved. They're that good. Teams are worried about them.
It's going to be fun. 8 weeks. Buckle in. Here we go. And we mentioned trophies, the ultimate trophy, the Stanley Cup. There's already some hardware that's been handed out. These trophies have already been won. The Art Ross Trophy, Connor McDavid. What a sensation. 100 points. The Rocket Richard Trophy for a second time. Sid the Kid grabs that. 44-goal season. The only guy to grab that with more than 40. There was one other 40-goal scorer, Austin Matthews. And the William Jennings Trophy goes to Braden Holtby. And by the way, Philip Grubauer, he should have been there with the Washington Capitals as well. One start short, one appearance short, and they're going to battle that.
You can petition for it, and I bet he's going to be at it.
And Grubauer should be there. So here's how it stacks up on the eastern side of the ledger. Montreal and the Rangers, original six action. Ottawa and Boston, first time they meet in 80-some years. Washington and Toronto, first time they ever meet in the postseason. And Pittsburgh and Columbus, always a nasty affair there. On the western side, Chicago, the number one seed. A lot of people think they're the cup favorites, taking on Nashville. Minnesota and St. Louis. Anaheim and Calgary, oh, there's some bad blood there. Edmonton and San Jose, and that's where we should start that great series.
Not many people can do that at speed.
McDavid scores! Connor McDavid's first career hat trick.
Outlet pass to McDavid, speeding in. Here is Connor McDavid! Upstairs! He scores!
Connor McDavid on the transition just says, see you later, and takes this one to the net. McDavid shoots! Scores! Connor McDavid!
And the kid lights this place up again.
I run out of words for Connor McDavid. You give that kid that much ice, forget it. It's all over.
Oh, what a series this is going to be. And it gets going on Wednesday at the beautiful Rogers Place. Sportsnet has it. 10 o'clock Eastern Time, 8 o'clock Mountain Time. We're going to have all these games coming your way as well. Sportsnet Now, live streaming of all the games. No blackouts there. Let's check out Oilers ringside reporter Gene Principe alongside Oilers captain Connor McDavid. Gene.
The room may be empty, but the feeling certainly isn't for Connor McDavid and the Edmonton Oilers. Fresh off an incredible regular season, what was it like for your team and for you to be involved in such success?
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. It's so fun to play with these guys. Everyone's close, and you see how the fans kind of ride behind us, and you know, that means a lot to us. It's fun coming to the rink and being a part of this, and we want to keep it going.
What was it like for you to mix team success with personal success, hitting 100 points and winning the Art Ross Trophy?
Yeah, honestly, it hasn't sunk in yet. know, it means so much. But like I keep saying, it's the group around, the guys that I played with, you know, everyone up and down the lineup. It's so fun to be able to play with these guys.
You faced San Jose, and this is a team that had a chance to win the Stanley Cup not that long ago. What do you think about going up against them in the first round and, you know, dealing with a club that has, at this point in time, more playoff experience than your team does?
Yeah, we understand the, you know, that experience, you know, thing, but, you know, at the same time, it's still hockey. It's still, you know, the game we've been playing since we were young, and, you know, obviously the stakes are a little bit higher, but it's the same game, so... you know, we feel good about our game right now, you know, but they have been there. They do have the experience, and you know, they know how to win, so we got our hands full.
I know as a kid you dream of doing many things, including playing in the NHL. What about the dream of being in the playoffs and having a chance to win the Stanley Cup?
Yeah, it's so exciting. I'm really looking forward to it. You know, it's been a long time since Edmonton's been in the playoffs, and you know, it's going to be a great experience.
Connor, thanks for your time, and good luck in the postseason.
Thank you.
And Gene, the hardware is going to start piling up for Connor McDavid. He's the favorite to win the Hart Trophy.
He's
in June
win
as well. There it
calling
is.
Calling it right here.
Definitive word from Elliot. He was sensational against the Sharks, no surprise. Five games. The Oilers win three of those games. He had multi-point games in four of those five battles versus the Sharks. What are they going to do to contain him?
Well, they better really pray a lot, because I'll tell you what, this is a major challenge. Peter DeBoer and his staff aren't sleeping very well, trying to figure out what are they going to do to contain this superstar speed. Well, what you've got to do, number one, is you play the same pair head-to-head, and the focus has got to be Vlasic and Braun. You've got to play them tight, and you've got to rely on your partner if you happen to get beat. Overplay McDavid, you play him tight, and your partner's got to do a superb job for you. I think Vlasic and Braun will be the guys. Look at the speed. This guy gets up to 38 kilometers. How do you contain that? So you play the Burns combo will be the second one with Martin. So I think the focus will be there. And also, you're going to have to play him mean. He's, you know, look, this is his first playoff. It's going to be a challenge for him. I still think he overcomes it. I think the Oilers win this series.
Wow. All right. So he's going out there. He's already making the predictions. We'll save that for the end of the show. But one thing we know is a fact is that Connor McDavid, if they're going to contain him, and maybe they'll slow him down, the other guys have to step up. And we've seen in the last couple of weeks, Eberle's gotten his stride going, as well as Milan Lucic. This could be huge.
Well, it's not could be huge. It has to be huge, Dave. Like, if you take a look at the National Hockey League, even your best offensive players now, they play much less than their counterparts did 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 years ago. The day the forward playing 25 minutes, it doesn't happen anymore. So you need multiple lines. It's ironic this game was against San Jose. I thought last week in this game against the Sharks, Milan Lucic was sending a message. He wasn't a force for a lot of the regular season, but he knows that even though he's not getting paid for the playoffs, he's really getting paid for the playoffs. Mm-hmm. And when Boston was a Stanley Cup champion and went to the final again in 2013, he was their emotional heartbeat. When he was riled up, the fortunes of the team rose with him. He needs to be that guy for the Oilers.
Hey, Eberle gets a hat trick in his last game. Nugent Hopkins has been a little bit better. Lucic has been a horse lately. They desperately need this line that's been so average to be good, and they've been much better lately. Critical for them to have this line going.
And they dominated the Pacific, 26-3 versus the Pacific, and Lucic creating all sorts of space. You know who doesn't get a lot of fanfare? The blue line. And I know they were dismal on Edmonton the last few years and rightfully discerned all the criticism they received. But what about this year? They're in the top third in goals against. Is this an underrated group of defensemen in Edmonton?
I think it is. I mean, you look at Larson, who came over in the Hall trade. He's been very solid for them. He's been very solid defensively. And he and Klefbom have been a good pair. Klefbom creating offense. Larson really being solid defensively. And Russell has come in and been a nice addition. So I think their top four is pretty solid, but they can get themselves in trouble when they don't make clear, direct, easy plays. Don't worry about the fancy play. Safety first, make the play second. And you see here where they get in all kinds of trouble. And this is both pairs. Their top four can really cause major problems for themselves by not coming out of the zone quickly and clean. Again, you see Larson here, good, solid defensive guy. He and his partner get tangled up. Not his regular partner, but Sakara, who has been good, but not great. I think the only chance that the Sharks have is that their big body forwards really cause havoc for what I think is an average blue line in Edmonton. Much better,
not as maligned, but still have a ways to go to be a top NHL blue line.
Well, Todd McClellan would love to win this series. Remember all those years he spent in San Jose, so he could get a little redemption for moving on to Edmonton. Here's how it stacked up. Again, the Oilers won three of the five matchups, and McDavid, again, four goals, four assists, four multi-point games. Definitely a force. Let's get you back to Rogers Place. Once again, here's Gene Principe.
David, I'm sure a lot of Oilers fans have been doing this lately.
Yeah.
Just kind of pinching themselves because they cannot believe the kind of season their team had in 2016-2017. As a hockey club, they had 103 points to finish second in the Pacific Division. Individually speaking, Connor McDavid hit 100 points and also is the winner of the Art Ross Trophy. And what do they get for all that? They get to face San Jose in the opening round of the playoffs, a Stanley Cup finalist last season. The biggest difference between these two teams is experience. The Sharks have more of it than the Oilers do, but Edmonton does have a player in Milan Lucic who is a Stanley Cup winner. Also star power with McDavid and Brent Burns. It should be a great series between one team that has already proved it can play in the postseason and one team that wants to prove that, David.
Gene, what a fun couple of weeks it's going to be in Alberta and really across Canada. But here we got Calgary and Anaheim. So you have both teams from Alberta in the playoffs. That starts Thursday, 10:30 Eastern, 8:30 Mountain Time on CBC. Again, you can catch it on Sportsnet Now, live streaming coming your way in a click. Let's get you out now to Calgary. Flames ringside reporter Roger Million sets the scene.
David, the Flames are getting set for Game 1 of their Stanley Cup playoff series with the Ducks in Anaheim on Thursday night. They'll focus on two key individuals, primarily goaltender Brian Elliott. He played 18 games in three rounds for the St. Louis Blues last season and was prolific in net. He'll have to stand equally as tall in this series against the Ducks. And their captain, Mark Giordano. Giordano was involved in an incident in the final regular season game against Anaheim, a collision with Ducks defenseman Cam Fowler. He suffered a knee injury, and Fowler is lost to the team for up to 6 weeks. Will Giordano be a target? The Flames say no, but general manager Brad Treliving not happy with comments coming out of Anaheim following that game. In fact, he called those words asinine. Fuel to the fire for Game 1 of this series. David?
Oh, Roger, it's not just a fire, it's an inferno right now. We'll have more on that in a second. The Flames, they struggled against the Ducks. Clearly, they haven't gotten things done in Southern California. Just one win in five battles. However, the postseason could be totally different. And you heard Roger Millions talking about the bad blood between these teams. Last time they played, 112 penalty minutes, 67 hits. The big hit, though, the one that Roger referred to, Giordano on Fowler Elliott.
Well, first of all, Bob Murray shouldn't feel bad because Brad Treliving has referred to my reporting as asinine on occasions, too. So it's not like it's the only first time he's ever used the word. You know, it's funny because Murray and I think Treliving are pretty tight, and this is what it does. And, you know, the one thing I think this was really about was, one, he was angry, Murray was, that he lost his best defenseman. Cam Fowler's had a great year. You know, I think he was going to get, not, he's not wasn't going to win the Norris, but I wouldn't have been surprised he was on a couple of ballots, and now he's out of your lineup. But I think what he was also trying to do is, hey, it's not the worst thing in the world if we get Mark Giordano in the penalty box a little bit. And I think that's what Brad Treliving is guarding against. Giordano, to me, he's on my Norris ballot. I think he's had a great year. And there's always a little bit of scheming that coaches do. And if they can get Giordano in the penalty box a little bit, that's a great thing for Anaheim and a really bad thing for Calgary.
Oh, I can't wait for this series. This is maybe the most anticipated series, at least as far as I'm concerned, because of what's happened in the last couple of weeks with these teams. What about defensively? You look at the Flames. It's not just the defense, but the offense they could bring, right, John?
Yeah, they really came on strong the second half. First half, they were a little sluggish out of the box, but they really come on and produced a ton of points. 176 points by the back end. We always said, if you get 150 points from your back end, you make the playoffs. And it starts with Brody. He's up ice. He makes plays. Brody jumps, and it totally confuses the defensive zone coverage. He's so agile, so quick. Giordano, same thing. He makes plays. He and Hamilton, again, are dangerous. This guy gets the puck through. And when you get the puck through the net, creates offense, tips, rebounds, deflections. Hamilton's been a real force. He and Giordano have been a great combination. Since they're put together, it's really changed the fortune of the Flames. For them to have success in this series, they've got to get points from this back end, and it helps the kids up front. So, look, this is going to be a hard-fought, vicious series. I love it.
When one team loses this series, the other team better look out.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's no, you're absolutely right. And the Flames hope it's the third time's the charm. They've played Anaheim twice in the postseason, lost both those series. Some more news coming your way from the NHL. Not a huge surprise. Vancouver Canucks fire their head coach, Willie Desjardins, as well. Florida, once again, they promote Dale Tallon to the GM duties. Tom Rowe reassigned to special advisor role. Trevor Linden, the president of the Canucks, had this to say about the Desjardins decision.
He's a great person. He's got great character, super hardworking, came to the rink every day, focused on winning. I think our decision was based on just the need to make a change. I think there's a feeling between Jim and I, there's some areas that we can improve on. And our team has transitioned significantly since our first year here, and we're going to be continue to get younger. And at this point in time, we felt a change was necessary.
All right, so there's Trevor Linden discussing the decision to change their head coaching situation. Elliot, what should we read into this?
Well, I think the interesting thing to me is that Willie Desjardins was in his first NHL job, and I think a lot of people thought that Vancouver would go after somebody with experience. On the weekend, it began to come out that maybe that wasn't the case, and Trevor Linden confirmed that on Monday, that experience maybe not the most important thing. I got to think, Travis Green's not going back to Utica. Either he's going somewhere else in the NHL, or he's going overseas. He's not going back to the American Hockey League for that team. I got to think that he's got to be your guy if you're Vancouver. I would be very curious to see why he wouldn't be their guy, because he's done a really good job with their American Hockey League team, especially this year when they were really shorthanded.
Meanwhile, Tom Rowe had his first opportunity as a head coach, and it went about as well as Willie Desjardins. What do you explain, or what do you think about the Florida situation?
Well, none of it made sense in Florida. Come on. You put Tom Rowe from a head coach in the American League to associate general manager, to general manager, to general manager and head coach. Are you kidding me? It's been a disaster. It's one of the biggest follies I've watched in the last 20 years in the National Hockey League. Owners got way too involved with coaching and taking bad advice. And I'll tell you what, they've taken a 103-point team, and now they've got themselves a mess. And now they got to bring Dale back, who they pushed aside, bumped upstairs, and now he's back in charge because the fan base is furious, and they should be.
And remember,
it's been a joke.
The fate of the furious.
Totally.
There you go.
Ridiculous.
Listen, Florida, one of the worst turnarounds in the wrong direction.
And good players.
They won the Atlantic last year. They're not in the postseason this year. Ahead, we're going to go inside an Original Six showdown, the Habs and the Rangers. Who's the favorite in this series? Answers coming up next.
Montreal wins the game 4-0 and the series 4-0. Most fans agree, this is the finest hockey team ever assembled.
He comes back to Bob Bond, he shoots, he scores! Bob Bond shot, bounced over Sachuk's shoulder into the corner. The game is over, and the Canadiens win the Stanley Cup for the 13th time. The game is over! The Cutaway boys have won the Stanley Cup!
It is now my very pleasant duty and responsibility to present the Stanley Cup to the Maple Leaf Hockey Club for the 11th time.
You are watching Hockey Central Stanley Cup Playoff Preview presented by the Fate of the Furious, coming your way on April 14th. In the playoffs, it's all about pride and passion. There are no paychecks. For the players, it's a chance to leave an indelible mark in the NHL history books. It's the allure of winning a Stanley Cup, especially in this, the centennial season. With more, here's Scott Morrison.
Over the years, one of our constants has been kids of all ages dreaming of one day winning the Stanley Cup. Even kids who have grown into men. And most won it countless times over. But only on the streets, the ponds, or in the local arena, in their dreams. Few have done it for real. It's an exclusive fraternity that felt the joy of capturing arguably the hardest trophy to win in pro sports, of understanding how 16 and a half kilograms of precious metal, 35 pounds, becomes as light as air when it's your turn to hold it high. Wayne Gretzky once said he was told you are never really a true superstar until you win it. Guy Lafleur reminded us years ago that you don't play just to have a good season, you play to win the Stanley Cup. In its own way, winning has meaning for fans too. When the Rangers won in 1994, ending a 54-year drought, a long-suffering supporter held up a sign that read, Now I can die in peace. Over the years, as the cup has grown in stature, both its size and mystique, how it gets presented has also changed, but not what winning it means. One of the great things about the cup is that since the 50s, the first person to accept it is a player, not an owner or a manager. And it has the name of every winning player engraved on it. Back in the 1950s, Ted Lindsay was the first to hoist the cup over his head and take it for a victory lap. It was a tribute to the fans that quickly became a tradition. Later on, the captain would pass the cup to his teammates, who would share it one by one. Sometimes the order of passing was random. Sometimes it had a purpose. Then came the team picture, the cup the centerpiece. And finally, the champagne. It was a New York sports writer who years ago might have put it best when he said, "One of the great rules of hockey is that on the Stanley Cup, all the germs are healthy."
All right, thank you, Scott Morrison. And here's how it shakes down. The Rangers and the Canadiens, an original six showdown. It's going to be sensational. It starts Wednesday on CBC at 7 o'clock Eastern. You can catch all the games on Sportsnet now, live streaming coming your way for each and every game. Let's get you to Montreal for Habs ringside host Kyle Bukauskas to set the scene. It's the Habs and the Rangers.
Well, David, it's a rematch of the 2014 Eastern Conference Finals here in the first round of the 2017 Stanley Cup playoffs between the Canadiens and Rangers. And in terms of that matchup 3 years ago, it's a series that many Habs fans will tell you they never truly got a fair fight in. We all remember the moment in Game 1 when Chris Kreider came sliding into Carey Price and ended his season, with all the pressure then falling on the shoulders of Dustin Tokarski, who had zero playoff experience, and the Rangers ultimately advancing to the Cup Final in six games. However, this time around, Montreal will have a healthy Price, and another thing that the Habs can hang their hats on heading into Game 1 at the Bell Centre is the fact that they swept all three games versus New York in the regular season. David?
And Kyle, you're absolutely right. There are the numbers. It was a sweep in convincing fashion as well. Montreal outscoring the Blue Shirts 12-7 in those games. What does that mean? Absolutely nothing. We'll find out if it means something, I guess, on Wednesday. The players on both sides, though, they say they're eager to get this thing going.
Yeah, me personally, obviously, I can't wait to get it going. And having a chance not to play last year was difficult, so you've been waiting all year to have that opportunity to play in the playoffs, and we're just excited.
I think once the playoffs start, you know, it's been proven in the past that eighth seed can win. It doesn't really matter where you finish or what your record was against the team. It's it takes a lot. A lot goes into winning the cup, and obviously we've got to start with a series against the Rangers and try and build our way up against them.
All right, so the scene has been set. It's going to be very interesting, an original six showdown. You look at the Habs season, 13-1-1, a historic start for them, a little bit of a lull. Then they fire their coach, bring in Claude Julien. They're back on the right side of the ledger. Carey Price, though, they're going to go as far as he carries them. Is he the best player to not be a Stanley Cup winner at this point in his career?
Well, 29 turning 30, he's on a mission. I mean, he desperately wants this to happen this year. I love this matchup for him. And look, since Terry has gone, Julien has taken over, he's been on his game as well as we've seen him play recently. I love the Ranger matchup. I think it's a good test for them, but I think they get by this and they'll build off this. Carey wants a chance to win the cup. He's moving into that age where he needs to win one soon.
Yeah, listen, no one's questioning their defense, their goaltending. What about the offense, though? And their main guy, their captain, Max Pacioretty, their offense goes through him. He's the catalyst. His numbers, though, varied through the season, Elliot. How do you explain the lack of offensive production under Claude Julien?
You know what I think it is? It's the way that Claude Julien wants him to play. Michel Therrien had a system that allowed his forwards to blow the zone. He had no problem with a defenseman banging the puck off the glass, and then you go and you create races. Under Claude Julien, it's very different. He wants you packed in tight. You know, when the Boston Bruins made their coaching change, one thing that Bruce Cassidy said was, "I don't need to change the way that we play defense." Mm-hmm. Claude Julien coaches it well. Our players know how to play it well. You have to stay low. You have to stay as a group. You're not allowed to blow the zone until somebody has the puck and you can all support it together. I think when you have a guy who it depends so much on speed and those foot races like Pacioretty does, I don't think Julian wants him to do it as much, so it makes him harder for him to break out with goals.
And they're going to need some goals from him. They only have two 20-goal scorers in Byron and Pacioretty. When you talk about defense and you talk about all those acquisitions the Habs made at the trade deadline, the big acquisition was last year, picking up Shea Weber. What do you expect from Weber here?
Well, look, what he's done five-on-five has been tremendous. He's been so solid, doesn't give up hardly a chance five-on-five. Very seldom gives up a goal five-on-five, especially in the last part of the season. But you've got to be careful with him as the playoffs go on because his foot speed can become an issue. Mm. We see in these clips where he gets caught standing still, and in the playoffs, the pace is much quicker. So Julian and the defensive coach are going to have to watch his foot speed, monitor him where he is, because he got in a lot of trouble last year in Nashville late. Early on, I think he's going to be terrific, but as it wears on, where will he be? He's that important, he's that good, but foot speed's an issue.
I think that's, I like what Montreal did the last week of the season. They rested him. Thought that was a really shrewd move, Dave.
Yeah, and it's going to be funny. We're always going to link Nashville and Montreal and those the big trade, Weber for Subban.
Nobody does that.
That's how Elliot's made a career, right? Now, another option for your viewing pleasure. Every Stanley Cup playoff game is on Sportsnet Now. There are no blackouts. Sportsnet Now is a streaming service that allows you 24/7 access to Sportsnet, including content you won't find on TV. Stream NHL, MLB, NBA matchups, and more on your mobile, tablet, or big screen. Visit Sportsnet.ca for more. Up next, the Senators and the Leafs back in the postseason. How will they match up against the surging Bruins and the star-studded Capitals? Oh, we will dig a little deeper. Hockey Central Stanley Cup.
Bobby Orr, behind the net, to Sanderson,
and
Orr! Bobby Orr!
McDonald, he scores!
McDonald wins it, the Leafs win it!
Strong way cutting, Sanderson wins it, they score! Bobby! Take Silver State and put Montreal Canadiens into the Stanley Cup Finals against the New York Rangers.
We have seven new teams from a year ago in the postseason. Look at the flip-flop we've seen in the Atlantic Division, where we have four different teams. Montreal, Ottawa, Boston, Toronto, none of them were in the postseason last year. All of them into the playoffs this year. I mentioned Ottawa and Boston. Well, they haven't met in the playoffs since 1927. That was for the Stanley Cup, my goodness. We're going to have it for you. Wednesday, Sportsnet, 7 o'clock Eastern, puck drop at the Canadian Tire Center. We'll have all the games, including a matinee on Saturday in Ottawa. It's going to be fantastic. And lots of questions surrounding the Boston blue line, their banged up crew. Carlo, are they going to be ready to go for game one? What about the Senators blue line, though? That's the big question. A couple of big guys to keep an eye on.
You know, it's kind of funny, Dave, because you would have said leading into this series that there's nobody that could have a more banged up blue line than Ottawa, and they've been handed the bit of the gift that Boston is struggling with that, too. I think the big one is obviously Mathot. There was some real fear after he was injured on the slash by Sidney Crosby that he could be out for a considerable amount of time, maybe this season. And now, we showed some viz on Saturday of them during their game against the Rangers, where it didn't look like he was very good at all, but now all of a sudden he's getting the glove on the puck, he's starting to look a lot better, and Guy Boucher, and the one thing you worry about in the playoffs is these coaches, they are big fat fibbers, and Doug knows because he was one during, when it comes to injuries, you cannot believe anything they can say, but if he can come back and play, it's a huge get for Ottawa.
I don't know if I can believe you anymore now.
Yeah, exactly.
But now you're one of us. But what about Carlson?
Because I'll tell you, he's that important to Carlson, too. Look, Carlson's had a marvelous season. He's been just spectacular to watch on a nightly basis. His defensive side of his game has gone to a whole nother level. Okay, enough blocking shots, though. Come on, that's why your foot is sore. I want to see him do a little more to help their power play, which, can you believe how bad this power play has been most of the season with this guy on the point? He's that good. He's that important. His defensive play is that strong. Their special teams have got to be a lot better for them to win this series. I picked them to win this series, but I think they've got to be better. Carlson, how much fun is he going to be to watch this playoff series? And with Mathot there, he'll be even better.
Ottawa's had the Bruins' number this year, 4-0. In fact, they've allowed just 6 goals to Boston in those 4 victories. We'll see if that can continue, though, when the games really, really do matter. All right, these games are going to matter. The Leafs and the Caps. The Leafs, welcome back to the postseason. Thursday, 7 o'clock, CBC, puck drop against the number one team in the nation, and that would be the Washington Capitals, who've been absolutely stupendous. Let's get down to the ACC, where we find Leafs ringside reporter Sean McKenzie.
David, the Maple Leafs are heading back to the playoffs, but they did not make things easy on themselves, matching up against the Washington Capitals in round one. But if there's any concern amongst Leafs players about going up against the President's Trophy winners, they are not showing it. Jake Gardner even said that they eventually have to beat the best. They might as well do it in the first round. The biggest concern for the Maple Leafs, though, will be the health of their back end. Both Nikita Zaitsev and Roman Polak were injured Sunday night. Their status, still a mystery. But healthy or not, Mike Babcock had a message for his team following Sunday night's game. He said when it comes to playoff hockey, don't just dip your toe in the water, run down the dock and jump right in. David.
Well, there you go. Works out at the cottage for sure. Listen, it's the rookies. It's all about the rookies with the Leafs. They're going to have nine players making their playoff debut, and they have the trio. Matthews, Marner, and Nylander, absolutely sensational. That's 32% of the Leafs' offense. They're going up against the stingiest defensive team in the National Hockey League in the Capitals. What challenges, though, could the Leafs' offense pose to Washington?
Well, I think the Caps are going to be a little bit caught off guard when they really watch this team and they really have a look at the speed they come at you with. It's unbelievable how they come at you through the neutral zone. Their D come up on the play, but they also come fast through the neutral zone. They back people off and really create space. The other thing they do is they do things at top speed. Top speed is the key. Here, you see them creating all kinds of space for the last guy to come in the rush. But have a look at this one where they come in the rush and it's four men coming hard at you. Drive the D back to the net, opens up things in the slot area. What I like about them and what will bother the Caps a little bit is the skill they do it with, the speed they do it with. McDavid does things at top speed. The Leafs do things at pretty close to top speed, and that's Matthews, Nylander, Marner. There's nobody, no, even veterans in the league can't do things with the speed they do it.
You know, there's a couple things I'm looking for here. Number one, you know, Toronto was such a huge underdog in this series. The Washington is the overwhelming favorite. What happens if Toronto gets one of those first two games on the road? Does Washington clench up, or do they trust the process? The second thing is, I remember a few years ago, guys, Keith Yandle, before his first playoff series, he was an offensive star for Arizona, and he said he realized how tough it was when you get game plan for in a seven-game series. He realized that Mike Babcock and Detroit were planning to shut him down. He was the focal point. I'm curious to see how all the Maple Leafs handle Matthews, Marner, Nylander, all those guys. Washington's going to game plan to shut down those guys. How do you handle it?
Little tip, if they win the first two in Washington, they'll win the series.
He's going out on a limb. Listen,
thanks a lot for that bold prediction.
First ever playoff meeting between the Capitals and the Leafs. That's kind of hard to believe, but adds a little bit of intrigue as well. The goaltending situation. Oh, boy. Braden Holtby could be staring down yet another Vezina trophy. He's been sensational. And look what he's done since January 1st. And Freddie Anderson, it's been steady Freddie. He's got to get healthy, but steady Freddie in net. Now, he's the one guy who hasn't been healthy, but check this out. Did you know? The Maple Leafs this year, they've been all about the health. They're the fourth team since 1967 to have nine players appear in every single game of a non-shortened season. First time in more than 40 years that has happened. So they've been incredibly healthy this season thus far.
This is the moment. History rewritten. New memories forged. Heroes vaulted. Dynasties established. Side by side, true North strong. This is the moment to bring Stanley home. Primetime Sports, weekdays with Bob McCowan.
Surprising story.
Ladies and gentlemen, from coast to coast, the 1988 Stanley Cup champions, the Edmonton Oilers.
Here comes the siren.
Here come the Flames, champions, 1989. A Stanley Cup has been won by Calgary.
Who wants to see the defending champs? Well, if you do, we've got them for you. Sportsnet 360, the series starts Columbus and Pittsburgh. Sid the Kid and the gang. Wednesday, it's coming your way, 7:30 Eastern time. All the games will be on the Sportsnet family of networks. All right, listen, Columbus, it was a horrible year last year. Such a difference. What a difference a year makes. 32-point improvement. But the question is, the Penguins, can they start their road to a repeat championship going through Columbus?
Well, the loss of Chris Letang makes it a lot harder because Letang was a guy, everybody forgets how great he was last year when they won the Stanley Cup. Mm-hmm. But when you look at their forwards and you look at their goaltending, you see a team that has the ability to beat a lot of other opponents. Sidney Crosby, look, he's not going to win the Hart this year. I think Connor McDavid is, but Sidney Crosby is still the best player in the National Hockey League, 200 feet on the ice. They have the ability to beat a lot of teams. Jim Rutherford won a Stanley Cup in Carolina with a defense that did not have a star. It had six very solid defensemen who morphed into a championship blue line. Guys, I think that's the big question. Can they copy that blueprint?
For me, the question is going to be, can Murray match up with Bobrovsky? Look, Bobrovsky's been the MVP of the Columbus Blue Jackets. That hasn't even been close for what he's contributed. But this guy's pretty darn good. We saw that last year in the playoffs. We've seen it all year. Bobrovsky, remember, in the playoffs a couple years ago, was not very good. Does he rebound? It looks like coming off the season he had, he's going to be real good. Bobrovsky versus Murray, to me, is the most intriguing matchup, and maybe a little punch-up between Sid and Dubinsky.
And listen, they each won two games during the season series, and they actually did contain Crosby a little bit, just the goal and two assists for Sid the Kid. But you're right, it could come down to goaltending. And we all remember the 16-game winning streak Columbus had. Well, they're kind of limping into the playoffs. Take a look at those numbers, guys. Should we read anything into this? Just three wins in their final 10 games, an anemic power play.
I like the way they finished against Toronto, a team that had a lot to play for, could have folded down 2-0 in that game, came back and won with the backup in net. I like Columbus.
But come on, they could have had home ice if they would have had a respectable finish. They had to go head-to-head against Pittsburgh. They got blown out. This is a big matchup. I think they come back strong in this series. I think it's going to be a heck of a series.
Coming up, are the Blues this year's sleeper team? We're going to ask a St. Louis insider. That's coming up ahead on Hockey Central Stanley Cup preview show. And two teams still searching for that elusive first-ever Stanley Cup. St. Louis and Minnesota, the action starts Wednesday, 9:30 Eastern on Sportsnet 360, followed up by Friday, Sunday, and Wednesday action on the Sportsnet family of networks. You can also catch it on Sportsnet Now. Interesting storyline in that series. Mike Yeo, yeah, remember him? He used to coach the Wild. So he's going up against his former team, as is Alain Vigneault going up against the Habs. And Todd McClellan, oh, he'd love nothing more than to beat his former team, the San Jose Sharks. Let's dig a little deeper into that St. Louis Blues-Minnesota Wild series with the Blues. Color analyst Darren Pang, who joins us now. Thanks for doing this, Darren. And maybe, just maybe, the Blues season turned around when they replaced Ken Hitchcock with Mike Yeo. And the former Wild coach, he's been a sensation in St. Louis, 22-8-2 since he was hired on February 1st. What went differently for this Blues team since that hiring?
Well, you know, David, for whatever reason, and Ken Hitchcock is known to be a great defensive coach, but they were a little out of sorts on the defensive side of the puck. They went into a little bit of a man-on-man. They strayed away from a real good tight zone. The first practice Mike Yeo had, Dave, he went right into a, you know, five-man tight unit, went in trouble, go to the front of the net, box out, leave the shots to the outside. Immediately, we saw results with the save percentage of the goaltending. We saw better defending in front of the net. fewer red zone scoring chances. And I think as a team, they gained confidence, David, because they knew that they had more energy on the offensive side of it and not wasting a whole lot of time in the defensive zone.
Which is funny because they also go and trade Kevin Shattenkirk, but still the team elevates itself into the situation they're in right now. Top 10 in both PK and power play. The special teams have been great. Would you consider the Blues maybe a sleeper team going into the postseason?
You know, the players don't think so. I've asked them that question, but I think around the NHL, yes. I don't think people realize from February 1st on, their five-on-five numbers, their special teams, their save percentage, it's better than any team in the National Hockey League. So there has been significant changes under Mike Yeo. Marty Brodeur has done a great job with the goaltenders as well. When you have goaltending that's so confident that they can win games, then as a team, that just trickles down. So yes, I'd say they're underdogs, but I don't believe they think they're underdogs.
And Darren, we always know it comes down to goaltending. You'd be the first guy to say that. Jake Allen, how different a goalie is he today from a year ago?
Well, number one, he's a battler to begin with. And Marty deserves a lot of credit. The defensive zone structure deserves a lot of credit. But I think the number one thing is he's staying on his edges a lot more, less sliding around, more in control. And that's been a big factor. The players have a great deal of confidence in Jake and in Carter Hutton, but in particularly Jake, because he was out of sorts for about 3 weeks. For him to find it back again says a lot about his character.
It's going to be fun, and the action starts on Wednesday on Sportsnet 360 and Sportsnet Now. Thanks so much, Darren Pang, for joining us here on Hockey Central.
Thank you, David.
And another series to keep an eye on, the Chicago Blackhawks, the number one seed in the West. You can catch them against the Nashville Predators. They've played the Predators twice in the postseason, and they've beaten them both in the postseason, and they've gone on to win Stanley Cups those 2 years. That gets going Thursday, 8 o'clock Eastern Time on Sportsnet. Should be a great battle. Joel Quenneville, Peter Laviolette, two Stanley Cup winning coaches going head-to-head.
Well, I think one team, our team here, when we play for keeps here, that's what it's all about. And we got some young guys, we're looking forward to their contributions as well. But it's a long season to put yourself in this position here, and this year it's so wide open that it should make for a great playoff, and you know, let's be ready to meet the challenge.
And another option for your viewing pleasure, Sportsnet Now. You can catch all of the action, no blackouts. Its streaming service allows you 24/7 access to Sportsnet, including content you want.
The NHL on Sportsnet, home of hockey's brightest stars.
Toffoli shoots, great save, rebound, they score! Alec Martinez gets the goal! The Los Angeles Kings have won the Stanley Cup! And that'll do it. The Pittsburgh Penguins have won the 2016 Stanley Cup.
And the road to the Stanley Cup begins on Wednesday. It all gets going with our preview, our setup from Hockey Central. Ron McLean, Elliot, Nick, and Kelly coming your way on Sportsnet. And then puck drops, 7 o'clock in Montreal and in Ottawa, CBC and Sportsnet. And then as well, we've got your American matchups, and we finish it up with the Sharks and Oilers, 10 o'clock Eastern on Sportsnet. Wall-to-wall hockey, 5 series get going on Wednesday. This is going to be a lot of fun as everyone's battling for the Stanley Cup. The fate of the Furious, April 14th, and there's going to be a lot of angry players out there who don't get their name etched on the Stanley Cup. Here's the part I love. Here's the part I know you don't love.
Oh, God.
Yeah, here we go. It's the predictions. So who are we starting with? Start with Elliot?
No, we're going with
Doug. Right. Doug, who's going to win the Cup? Who's going to win the East? Who's going to win the West?
Well, look, it's getting tougher every year. There's no doubt about it. But I'm taking the Washington Capitals to beat the Chicago Blackhawks in a 7-game series. And I'm going to say it because I think Holtby's become one of the great goaltenders in the National Hockey League. A solid blue line with a Shattenkirk acquisition. And Kuznetsov is matured. He was awful last year in the playoffs. He and Backstrom are going to be too good down the middle. Oh, I forgot about number 8. Yeah, he's got to be better. He's got to be really good this year, and they're going to beat the Chicago Blackhawks in 7.
Do I have to do this?
Yeah, you have to.
Just copy me.
I basically did.
You're obligated.
They told me I had to do this. Garrett, our producer, told me I had to do it. So I copied Doug's prediction, but I didn't want it to be exactly the same. So I flipped it around. I'll take Chicago over Washington. You know what? I'd really love to see. I hope sometime in our lifetime we get to see a Chicago-Pittsburgh Stanley Cup final with Crosby against Taves. I just don't think this is going to be the year. I think Washington's too good.
Now, I picked Chicago over Tampa in September.
Okay.
I was a little off on that one.
A lot of people picked Tampa.
I picked Washington preseason over Nashville. That could still happen, but no one's asking my opinion. I'm going to give it to you anyway. I think it's going to be the Caps over the Flames. Yeah, the Flames in the Stanley Cup final. Oh, it's going
Lucky
to be fun.
I went first.
8 weeks and someone will be hoisting the Stanley Cup. It all starts with Hockey Central Stanley Cup playoff. We get you going Wednesday, 6:30 Eastern. Ron McLean and the gang. Enjoy it all on Sportsnet and Sportsnet Now.